heads down.
In the back, juices, chocolate milk, coffee, any of those things. If you need something, let us know. We'll try to help you the best we can. We did add some new books today to the book library that were basically it's a donation library, but we added about 10 or 12 books from Oliver B. Green. I have most of his series and I have duplicates of that, so we added those as well. Again, any of the books over here are donation-based, except for the Bibles at the top. I think the Webster's Dictionary and some of the other ones, just because there was a cost involved in the church originally purchased those. So, but we're glad to see you this morning, and we'll be adding over the next few weeks. I got a present from my father. He brought me about 15 cases of books, and so I'm currently going through them and all the duplicate stuff and different things we're adding. And giving those away for a reasonable price. So we have some new Bibles possibly that'll be out here as well. And so we'll let you know as we get closer along. And each week we add something, I'll let you know, hey, we added something new. And so you can get those items. Again, if you're interested in the book that we're doing with the series, Change It to His Image, we've got three of these still available. Those are $15 a day. But we're going to start our class this morning with a song. So, song leader and piano player, take it on.
Yeah. Brother, this is John. Asked me how many songs I have, and I said only four this morning. All five verses. Let's open up our songbook this morning and turn to number 35. 35. Since. Preacher's over here trying to remember what number 35
was. Since Jesus came into my heart.
Since Jesus came into my heart. Yes. First and last verse.
Make sure that gets turned into the treasurer's office. James chapter 1, today, James chapter number 1. We're on session number 3 of our series, Changed into His Image. And so we're excited about how the Lord's working through this series. Hopefully you're not mad at me from last Sunday morning when I said that we're all evil. All of us are wicked. And your child's not perfect, your child's evil. Just like my children are evil. And so, we talked about the heart that's within. And today we're going to be dealing with identifying your own way. Identifying your own way. So even though we're saved and children of God, we still have a struggle in our own heart. Our heart is deceitful and wicked, and we want our own way. And so we're going to talk about that today. James chapter 1, verse number 13, the Bible says this: let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Identifying our own way. Here's some knowledge objectives we want to work on today. Explaining why rebellion of our own way manifests itself differently in each of us. By the way, I forgot to mention, if you'd like a clipboard for notes, we've got them over here. You can grab those and a pen if you want to take notes today. But why rebellion of our own way? What you want and what I want is different. What I want and what my wife wants sometimes is different. And our own way manifests itself differently in each of us. Secondly, we want to recognize the different kinds of rebel ways in your own life and the lives of those with whom you live and to whom you minister. So those who have children, we're going to identify the rebel in your kid. You say, not my precious angel. Remember last week, your angel's not so precious. They're wicked and evil. Their heart is wrong. And so we're going to talk about that also. We're going to know why there is a hope for any of us who wish to make biblical change. There is hope. You don't have to stay evil. You don't have to stay wicked. There is hope to change your life. So we're going to talk about that today. And we're going to talk about the application of doing that by responding, by being much more cautious of your own actions and reactions in the hot water situations. As we talked about in week 1, we took that tea bag and put it in the cup of hot water, and the water didn't make the tea made the tea. What was in the bag came out through the hot water of life. And what's in your heart and in my heart comes out in the hot water situations of life. Next, we're going to respond by encouraging others who have lost hope about making biblical change. You may be here this morning thinking, well, there's no hope. Everybody's wicked. There's no hope for Christian people to get better. We're just wicked people. Nope. There's hope for biblical change. And thirdly, we're going to respond by asking God to increase your awareness of your rebel ways and my rebel ways. And once we identify them, we're going to repent of them. Amen. We're not going to continue in them. We're going to repent of them, and we're going to depend upon Him, God, to help us to change. So we're going to identify those and help us today. So identifying your own way. Now, everybody here grew up differently. I had the opportunity. I grew up in southern Georgia for the first 10 years of my life, and then I moved to the state of Indiana. Georgia and Indiana are vastly different places. They talk differently. They have foods that they like in different places that they don't like in other places. And so they're different in the way that they call things. If I held up to you this morning a Coca-Cola can, what would you say I was holding in my hand?
A Coke.
Soda pop.
A soda pop.
Soda pop. Coke. Everyone's got a different term for that, depending on how you grew up. Some people call it a Coke, even if it's Pepsi, Mountain Dew, Dr. Pepper, something else. They still call it it's a Coke. That's the way they grew up. Some people call it soda. Some people say, that's stuff I'm not allowed to drink. based upon the way they grew up. So the way you grow up and the nature of your nurture has an effect on your lust. Now, all of us have lust that we struggle with, but the nature of your nurture. Now, if you grew up in a home that you had bacon with every breakfast, and then you got married, and the person you got married to didn't have bacon with breakfast, they only had cereal and fruit, you would have a struggle there. Because you're expecting bacon, and they didn't grow up that way. You have different palates of food, per se, that you grew up with and somebody else grew up with, and you like this, but your spouse doesn't like this. They didn't grow up that way. They didn't have that. They don't like that. There are some people who are mashed potatoes and vegetable and meat people. And there are other people who grew up totally different than that. And they're not used to that style of cooking or food. And so based upon your nurture, how you grew up, some of you grew up in a situational home life that maybe your parents were yellers. They yell all the time. And so you grew up in that life, but the person you got married to, they grew up in a real quiet, calm, peaceful environment. And so you start yelling and they start stressing out because of your nature of how you grew up. So the nature of our nurture. So for instance, we can say, if you grew up with lobster and caviar and all those things, and then you married somebody that grew up with fried bologna sandwiches and those type of things, you guys would have two different natures. One would expect a certain quality, and the other one would be fine with the quality that they have. So the difference when it comes to food shows us that, but it also comes that way if you grew up in a home that you took a vacation every year to a nice fancy place, and the other people grew up in a home that the only vacation they have is they went to the free park and spent time there and they camped in a tent. You'd have two different completely expectations, desires, and wants. So the way you grow up, the nature of your nurture affects you. In fact, your nature helps develop you to have designer lust. The unique combination of your own heart with the nature that you grew up in, the nature you've been surrounded with, causes you to have designer lust in your life. You crave certain things. You want certain things because of how you grew up. Things that you were exposed to has made it easier for you to desire those things. So we've got to identify that. So what happens is we're identifying our own way. You saw the picture at the beginning. So there's different types of rebels. Different types of rebels. Number one rebel today is the assertive rebel. You know this rebel. Their mask says, I won't obey, I won't do it, you can't make me. How many of you have met an assertive rebel or had to deal with an assertive rebel in your house? I won't, you can't make me do it, I will not. That type of rebel, many people can identify. The second one this morning is the cooperative rebel. The cooperative rebel. Now this person says, I will obey since it gets me what I want. I'll obey since it gets me what I want. So they're compliant. Okay? No problem. In other words, it's probably more identified as the really good kid. They're doing it out of a sense of duty, not because they have a heart for God, not because they're desiring to please God. They're just doing it because my mom will be off my case if I obey. If I do what I'm supposed to do, everybody will be fine with me. And no one will give me grief. No one will give me problems. adult life, I show up to church. I was in the building. I did what my duty, and now I can go and live my life whatever way I want to live it. Because I did my duty. I showed up to church. I sat in the service. I did the good Christian thing. But if your heart's not in it for the Lord, you're just being cooperative.
That's right.
You're just doing what you're supposed to do because it's the right thing to do. I had a teenagers we dealt with. As you know, my wife and I worked in youth ministry for years, and you'd ask them the question, why do you come to church? Because it's the right thing to do. Well, it is. It is the right thing to do. God's people ought to come to church. But you'd ask them the reason, why? Well, because it's the right thing to do. Well, why is it the right thing to do? So then you'd have kids who say, well, it's because I learned more about God. That's true. You should go to church to learn more about God. Amen. You should do that. But that's not the sole purpose of coming to church.
Amen.
I come to church to see my friends. Now that transcends not just teenagers, but adults. I come to church for the fellowship. I got my friends there, people there. They feed us breakfast. They give us free coffee. I like that place. I come for those things. That's not the reason to come to church.
Amen. Right.
You're coming out of duty. You're coming out of the likes that you have. Why do you come to church? And we'll get to that a little bit later. So the cooperative rebel is the one, I just do it to cooperate so I don't get in trouble. They just leave me alone so I can do what I want to do. So after that, there's another mask. This is the passive rebel. The passive rebel. This is the one who says, I can't obey. I can't go get a job. I can't move out, Mom. I don't know how to take care of myself. I can't. I'm not able to. I don't know how to. I'm just laid back. That's the terminology for the day. You know what the Bible calls being laid back when you don't want to? Slothfulness. Laziness.
Amen.
I just can't. I don't know how to. No, you can. You just don't want to. So I can't obey. Lord, how about this one? I forgot. Somebody asked you to take the trash out. I forgot, Dad. What do you mean you forgot? What have you been doing? I've been playing video games. No, you didn't forget. You just didn't want to. Come on. It wasn't on your priority list. I forgot. Now, how's that translated to adulthood? I forgot to read my Bible. I forgot to talk to people about the Lord. I forgot. No, it wasn't a priority. So the passive rebel says, I can't, I forgot to, or I didn't know to obey. I didn't know I was supposed to do that. What do you mean you didn't know that? I didn't know that I was supposed to clean my room. How many times have we told you to clean your room? Often. But you didn't tell me today. So I didn't know I was supposed to do it today. But didn't you? Weren't you told yesterday and the day before and the day before? And as some parents would say, I told you 1,000 times. Well, did you really count them all to make sure it was 1,000? The dog says, yes. We're on 997 times. But I told you. Listen, I didn't know. You didn't tell me today. But what it is there are expectations given by authorities that we expect behavior. We expect actions, and we shouldn't have to tell you. You shouldn't have to tell your teenage son, put your deodorant on. He should arrive at the conclusion he needs to put his deodorant on. He should already know that. He should live that way in his life. But we have that, I don't know, I didn't know. And so many times that passive rebel comes into play in our Christian life. I didn't obey. I can't. You know, whatever way it illustrates itself out in your life, whether you're, no, God, I'm not going to obey. Or, yeah, God, I'll obey just so the preacher don't bother me. I'll show up to church so. Or it's, I didn't know. I wanted to, but I really struggle with. All of those identify the problem. The problem is we want our way over God's way. Whether we're assertive about it, whether we're cooperative or passive about it, it identifies our problem. Our problem is you want what you want, and I want what I want. Instead of developing a biblical change that we want what God wants. So we've got to change our want to. So God has a certain change in mind for all of us this morning. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, take your Bibles and turn there. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 this morning. God lays out for us a change that he wants to take place. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 11. Verse number 11 says, "And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, and by the Spirit of our God." The list before that lists all of these things, and we talked about them. Adulterous. Oh, that's wonderful. Unrighteousness shall be not seen either. Fornicators, adulterers, idolaters, effeminate, abusers of themselves, thieves, covetous, drunkards, revilers, extortionists. All of those people were, past tense, some of us. That'd have been a good spot to say amen. Were. But here's the struggle with most Christians. It's not past. It's still part of your life. You haven't put it in the past. You haven't done what we talked about on Wednesday night with removing and replacing. You have to have both. In order to be effective for God and for God to allow biblical change to take place in your life, you've got to remove and replace. The problem with Christians today is Christians live like the world. They act like the world. They talk like the world. They do everything just like the world. God has not established biblical change in their life because they got one set of tracks, and their tracks is my way. That's the tracks they're on. Well, you need God to switch the track. And when he switches the track, you don't go down the other track anymore. Now, here in El Reno, we're doing a construction project over on Highway 81, Route 66. Putting in a new bridge. I discovered something. There's another train track under that bridge.
Yeah, there is.
How many of you knew there was a train track under there? You El Reno people, you knew that. Some of us that just moved here, we didn't know there was another track under there because you never saw it from the bridge. You knew where the train tracks went. So when I first came across the tracks, I slowed down almost to a complete stop because I didn't want to get hit by a train because there's no train signal coming across them. And then I discovered no train goes down that track. It's a storage track. It's where they park train stuff and supplies. The train doesn't travel that way. The train goes the other way. You know what's happened in a lot of Christian lives? We've been on the same track for so long that we don't allow God through his word and biblical change to switch the track to a different track. That it's just a storage track for us. We read the Bible, we just store it aside, we don't apply it to our life. We read about the things of God, but we don't live them out in our lives. And so we've got this storage track of biblical truth that we never frequent and we never use. There's a lot of Christians who know about God, but don't live for God. Who know they should be on that track, but they're not on that track because it's been so easy to be on the track of their own. So you got to begin by asking this question. What is the ruling lust in my heart right now? What's the ruling lust? What's the number one thing I feel the most secure when? When do you feel the most secure? When all the bills are paid? I feel the most secure maybe when you're at home all by yourself. I feel the most secure when I'm in control. Can anybody identify with the three statements that we made? I feel the most secure when I'm at home in my own. I feel the most secure when I'm in control. I feel the most secure when I've made sure that the bills are taken care of and there's money in the bank. I feel the most secure then. What about this? All I want to have, be, or do is be, and fill in the blank. Well, I want to be happy. That's all I want from life. I want to be happy. I want to be wealthy, long as I'm wealthy. I want to be a professional baseball player. I want to be this, or I want to be that. I want to be well taken care of. Can anybody identify with the statements that we've made? The thing I worry about most is, what do I worry about most? My health, my kids, my finances. What do I worry about most? What do I worry about most? I worry about my marriage. Worry about my job, if it's going to be there or not. What do I worry about most? The thing that keeps me awake is my husband snoring. The thing that keeps me awake is fear. What was that noise? What was that? The thing that keeps me awake is worry. The thing that keeps me awake is, will there be enough money to make rent next week? What keeps me awake is, you got to figure it out. I go into a panic when I'm not accepted by other people. When people are mad at me. I go into a panic when everything's not right. I go into a panic when frustration's on the job. I go into a panic when fill in the blank for you. I get most angry when. What is it? Get most angry when not enough money to pay the bills. I get most angry when I don't get my own way. I get most angry when things happen out of my control. I get most angry when fill in the blank. I tend to get very discouraged when. Get discouraged when this happens, or get discouraged when that happens. All of these things cause us to reflect on some very important thing in our life. It's an I and a my. I feel the most secure when I, all I want to have me do all I want, I worry about, I stay awake because I get most angry, I tend to get discouraged when this, when that. Now let's pause for a minute. Who are we to think that we have to have it our way? Christianity is not Burger King. You don't get to have it your own way. Christianity is living a life pleasing to God and giving God His way in your life.
That's right, amen.
His way. So I feel most secure when I realize God is in control. I feel secure then. All I want to have is what God wants for my life. The thing I worry about most is, well, God did not give me the spirit of fear, the power. I worry about most when I don't consult God with what I worry about. That's when I worry most. The thing that keeps me awake is when I don't bring into captivity my thoughts into subjection to the Word of God. I go into a panic when I fully don't trust that God is able to deliver me. I get most angry when I don't live in the spirit, but I live in the flesh. tend to get very discouraged when I do what I want to do and I forget about what God has done for me. See, there's two ways. There's God's way, there's our way. All of us in the room can identify with one of the three rebels we talked about. All of us in the room, preacher included, have a rebellious spirit at heart. You can be assertive. I'm not going to obey. I'm not going to do it. You can be the cooperative one. I'll do it because it's the right thing to do. But my heart's not in it. I'm just going through the motions. Or you can be the passive one. I didn't know. Oops. I fell into sin. God, please forgive me. No. All of us are rebellious when we want it our way. And that's the struggle, isn't it? Because most of us, we've got one train track that we've lived on our whole life. And to switch tracks to allow our lives to be guided by God means letting go of the controls and letting God have his way.
Amen.
But it's a struggle. Now, how many would agree that you can identify in your own heart which type of rebel you are? How many of you think you know which one you are? Okay. Many of us do. We can identify that, yeah, that's me. I'm that one. I'm that type of rebel. And at the end of the day, we must realize that rebellion is not part of a Christian life. It's not to be part of our lives. And your lust and my lust are different. We have designer lust. Partly because of the nature of our nurture, how we grew up, and things we've been exposed to. A person who grew up in a household where pornography was a daily part of their life, they, the designer lust, they struggle more with pornography than a person who's never ever looked at it, seen it, been around it their entire life. You say, well, they just have a hunger for it. No, they don't. It's a sin choice. It's a choice. Everyone here chooses to follow God, or everyone here chooses to sin. We're going to talk about salvation here in the morning service, and we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to confront the false teaching of Calvinism this morning. And I'm going to prove it to you from Scripture how detrimental it is.
Amen.
To think that doctrine is biblical. And we'll do, there's, in order to believe in Calvinism this morning, you got to do a lot of exegetical gymnastics. You got to change the meaning of verses to mean what you want them to mean, and you got to add words to it. And I better stop, or I'm going to go into the preaching for the morning service. But in our lives, we so many times choose our way, but you got to identify you're a rebel. You're a rebel. Now, there's a lot of people who don't want to identify that I'm a rebel at heart. And you're a rebel at heart. But you're either that assertive one, the cooperative one, or the passive one. Now, who this morning wants to be brave and share with us the struggle you have about being a certain type of rebel? Rodney?
Everybody listen to the pastor because he reads. We live and learn.
the nature of the nurture. And you and I can all be part of the same church here at Bible Baptist Church and respond differently because of the nature of the nurture of what you grew up in. And so understanding that about yourself, what type of rebel you are, is helpful and beneficial. Brother Don?
I'm not going to stand and say what I am.
Okay.
But I have a question. Can we, at different times in our life, be assertive, cooperative, and passive?
Mm-hmm. I think so. I think even with certain things, at certain times, we can do that. You know, there are certain things that we're assertive about, and there's certain things that we're passive about, and there's certain things that we're cooperative with. And so, in our life, we could be all three at the same time by choices that we make. But the identifying factor is, it's your choice. You choose to be that type of rebel. You choose to act out that way. You choose to handle the situations that way. Now you say, well, it's just my nature. Yeah, it's your sinful nature, but it's your nature. Oh, let me remind you, learned behaviors can be unlearned. The way you've handled your life, the things that you've done, because of the way you learned how to, you can unlearn those behaviors.
Amen.
There's a person that I know, a married couple got married, and the wife struggled when they first got married. She grew up in an environment she was like her father. When her father and her mother had an argument, boom, dad would run away. That's what he did. He'd shut down, close the door, didn't want to deal with the situation. So husband and wife get married. They have their first argument. What does she do? Whew. Runs to the bedroom, slams the door, cries into the pillow. Woo-hoo-hoo. The husband, on the other hand, he doesn't know how to handle this. He's got to figure this out. This is not how he learned how to handle problems. It's not how he grew up. Are you listening? But thankfully, after years of marriage, she learned to unlearn the behavior that she naturally had. And now she does much better. Now the husband's the one who runs away because she's, no, I'm just kidding. That's not true. But the behaviors changed because learned behaviors can be unlearned. Aren't you thankful for that? That you can unlearn some things that are contrary to God. Yes, sir.
You have five sons.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say you give this same work or work command.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe from the Word of God.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Have you not seen, based on their personality,
mm-hmm,
how they
handle it different? Yep.
How they handle it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So, as a parent, you think God is the parent, and all of us are so different. How does He have the patience? He does.
Yeah.
That's what I'm always
wondering. Yeah. Because He is long suffering.
That's right.
His patience is so long suffering for some of us that it's amazing that we're still here on the earth.
Amen.
Because if you and I were God, when it came to dealing with some people, we would make sure the lightning bolt just came down and zapped it. Because we would say, I've had enough. I give you time and time and time. Lightning bolt. But God's merciful. And His mercies are new every single day. And so it's just amazing when you stop and consider, when we identify our own way, become changed into His image. What is His image? Was Jesus a rebel?
No.
Well, at times He rebelled against the thinking of the day. So it's okay to be an assertive rebel when it comes to things that are contrary to the Word of God and God's plan. It's okay to speak out against things that are contrary to the Word of God and what God would have for us. So, but you and I must be careful when we identify our own way, what train tracks we're living in. Because as I mentioned to you earlier, when we take that time to reflect, we find out it's me, it's mine, it's I. Instead, we leave God totally out of the picture. Even Christians who grew up in church who know what we're supposed to do, but we don't do it. It's a struggle. That's why sanctification. is progressive. It's not a one day flip the switch, I'm all good. No, it's day after day after day after day, getting more like Christ. And when you finally get there, it'll take you home to heaven.
Amen.
It'll be time to go, because you'll be like him. But until we get there, it's going to be a struggle. So let us live day to day with the heart's desire of this. Is it God's way or my way that I want to live in today? Think about it. So look forward to next week, lesson number 4. As we dive into lesson number 4, change to his image. Again, if you want a copy of the book, we have those available. It's a great series. You're going to really, really enjoy it. All right? Good to see you this morning. Thanks for being here. Thanks to the Harrises once again for breakfast. You guys have a great morning. We're going to see you in the morning service here in about 10 minutes. You are dismissed this morning.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.
You know, preacher, you know, when I used to argue with Tommy as if that I wanted to be able to get even, I always remembered what you said. It's not me, it's about him. And every time I think about that, I just start thinking he's saying that every time I get in